Give me land, lots of land under starry skies above. Don't fence me in. Let me ride through the wide open country that I love. Don't fence me in. Let me be by myself in the evening breeze and listen to the murmur of the cottonwood trees. Send me off forever, but I ask you please, don't fence me in.
Good day, Radio Rick Spector here with the next installment of Movie House Productions' Exploring Old Philly Neighborhood series. Today, a trip back in time to Northwest Philadelphia's West Oak Lane. And we're brought to you by Nabisco's Shredded Wheat. Our special guest is that cultural whirlwind, Joel Spivak. Joel was born in West Philly, moved to West Oak Lane in the 40s, and lived there until he was 21. 6628 North Gratz was where Joel called home in West Oak Lane. Joel's an architect, artist, author. He's also contributing mightily to the revival of South Street. Joel is a published authority on trains and trolleys and the founder of Philly's National Hot Dog Month. Joel, you've got a lot of the urban explorer in you. I can see where your theme song, Don't Fence Me In, really applied to your boyhood. In fact, I think you were born to be wild. Welcome, Joel.
I'm doing great, Rick. How you doing? Okay.
Joel, for those of our listeners not familiar, what are the street boundaries of the West Oak Lane section of Philly?
Well, it's interesting because everybody has a different story about where it is. For me, basically, there were a couple boundaries, and it was more like how the neighborhood changed. It was around Limekiln Pike to the west, Cheltenham Avenue, obviously, because that was the end of Philadelphia, Broad Street, which everybody said was the border between West Oak Lane and Oak Lane.
Joel, for our viewers, your parents were very special people. Can you tell us about them?
Yeah, well, they were really wonderful people, and they loved to have fun. My mother, before she had us, was a professional singer, blues singer on the radio. She sang on WHAT a couple times a week, and she sang at the Massbaum Theater. And my father was the star baseball pitcher at the National Farm School, 1929, 1930, 31. And my mother became the chairwoman of the flag raising committee during World War II. And she would be out on the porch singing the national anthem and raising money for war bonds.
Joe, you were a guy who got around as a kid. You still do. How did your exploration of your neighborhood, West Oak Lane, begin?
Well, the first part started when I was able to cross the street myself. I was able to get to elementary school, which was two blocks from my house. And then in elementary school, I met different people, and they lived, you know, maybe a mile north of the school or half a mile to the west of the school. So by visiting their houses and then, you know, playing after school, like, oh, and here's where my candy store is, and here's where we deliver the papers or something. And then every neighborhood had like a story, a house that was haunted or something.
And what was your elementary school?
I went to Rowan Elementary School.
Okay. And where was that located?
Haynes, Ogons, and 19th Street. It was built in the 1930s. It was a very modern school.
Joe, a guy who got around a lot, one of the places early you told us that you went to was the old Bromley Ruins and the woods associated.
Right.
What was that about? Who was Bromley?
Well, we never knew, actually. We thought he was related to the movie theater, the Bromley Movie Theater, which was about a half a mile south of this. But this was about a two-square-block area right in the middle of East Oak Lane, you know, off Old York Road. And it had a stone wall around it, and it had a tunnel into it, which the story was that's how the servants brought the food into the kitchen or something. Their foundation was still there, like about 3 inches up off the grade. And there was like a big fountain with lion heads, and the stream went through it, took in a creek. And on, apparently this was some big fancy place in the middle of nowhere. And it burned down. Nobody knew exactly when it burned down. Everybody said it burned down in the 20s or 30s. And we played there, and pretty amazing on the Facebook page, West Oak Lane Facebook page, lots of kids played there. That was like the greatest treasure of you. When you went in the middle of it, you were very kind of isolated. You didn't realize you were in your own neighborhood.
For the record, who was this guy Bromley that you explored his estate room?
Yes. Well, one person said it was the Bromley Lace Company owned the property, and they had a factory somewhere in Philadelphia. We kind of went places, took walks, looked at stuff, sat on Ogonce Avenue and watched the trolley car go back and forth. In fact, we had trolley cars on Cheltenham Avenue and trolley cars on Ogonce Avenue. And one of our things was there was always a way to make some money once you got to be about 8 or 9 years old. Because there was a lot of commercial stores up Ogonce Avenue and, of course, in Philadelphia in our neighborhood. Every corner had a store on each corner. So if you went to the intersection, there were 4 stores. And you could always go there on trash day and say, I'll take the trash out, or I'll sweep the floor, or I'll stock the shelves or something. And another way was for the pharmacies would have the prescriptions delivered. So if the cost of the drugs were like $2.75, they would say, who wants to take the order? And then you would, you know, get the order, and they would give you the change. So if the person gave you a $5 bill, you had exact change to change the $5 bill, plus in small, you know, nickels and dimes, so that they would give you a tip. So you would deliver the prescription, we were about 2 blocks away, to get a dime from the person that they delivered it to, come back to the drugstore, and he would make you an ice cream soda or give you a comic book.
So, what were some of the popular stores?
The stores, well, there was a Bogoslavsky's Bakery, and there was a deli that was in the neighborhood. Ben and Irv's was in the neighborhood, and they became a very famous Jewish deli, moved to the Northeast.
Yes.
And Broad and Olney was a really big business shopping area. They had a lot of stores there, L'Oreal clothes or something. And for the men's clothes, there was Jack Parrish was like the hip clothes of the time.
Joel, we're going to take a brief break now for a word from our sponsor, Nabisco Shredded Wheat. So we'll be back in a minute.
N-A-B-I-S-C-O, Nabisco is the name to know. For a breakfast you can't beat, eat Nabisco Shredded Wheat. And you know something, boys and girls? The right thing for you to do when you see a dish of Nabisco Shredded Wheat in front of you is to reach for a spoon and start eating. Yes, those delicious Nabisco Shredded Wheat biscuits topped with milk and sugar are really something, and something you'll want plenty of. You see, Nabisco Shredded Wheat is pure whole wheat, rich natural grain that's grown out on the Western Plains. Yes, it's mighty good tasting, and a mighty fine energy food to keep you going strong all morning long. Tell Mother it's Nabisco Shredded Wheat for you tomorrow morning, sure.
Joel, we're back with you. Talk about that commercial. That was a favorite of yours. It was from a radio show called The Straight Arrow. And you made that change from radio to television back there in the late 40s and early 50s. What was it like?
Well, it was, in a way, kind of interesting. But in a way, the TV was not as interesting as the radio.
How so?
When you listen to the radio, you laid on the floor. And you just like close your eyes and you followed along the story where they were, you know, telling you what they were doing, and they had sound effects. In your mind, you had created these amazing people, like Superman was like really cool and fantastic and flew away. And what was another one? There was the Shadow, and there was Straight Arrow, and there was Sergeant Preston of the Yukon. And then when they became TV shows, the TV was pretty primitive. And it wasn't very interesting. I mean, there was no special effects or anything. And in a way, the heroes didn't look as cool as they did in your mind. And also about that time, we were more into meeting girls and thinking about learning how to drive. We had a game called Making a Loop. And on Sundays, kids rode free on public transit. So one of us had to decide to make a loop around Philadelphia. And we would jump on the bus. You know, we'd go to the corner, wait for somebody, an adult, to come up. When the bus came up, the adult would take us on. They take us on, and they would take you on the bus. And, of course, once you were on the bus, you could just ride forever. So we would take the bus all the way to Frankfurt, or and then we would get on the L, and we would take the L all the way to 69th Street, and then we would get off the L, and we would get on the E bus, which would take us to Germantown and Chelton. And then Germantown and Chelton, we got on a 52 trolley, which would take us back to Ogontz Avenue. To go to Willow Grove Park when it was open and go on amusements, but one of our adventures were, we would go up when it was closed. I don't know if they closed, you know, around Halloween or whatever it was, but they were not open in the winter. And we would go up there, and we would climb over the fence, and we would go into all the amusements. We would go in the fun house, play in the fun house. We would come out. We would walk up. We would go up on the roller coaster. We had a big playground up there. It was all abandoned. There were no watchmen or anything like that. And that was one of our fun things to do. And then we would go across the street. There was a steak sandwich place called Luigi's Steaks. It was really good. We would have a steak sandwich, and we would get back on the trolley.
Joel, you spent a lot of time at the movies as a kid. What were your favorite theaters in West Oak Lane?
Well, I liked the Ogontz Theater. It was one of my favorites because that was a big, grandiose theater with balconies, and it was a very elegant, beautiful thing, vast auditorium. But we had so many different movies, and they were actually, in a way, I think about them being an inspiration for my architecture idea. Because each one was really different, and they were built in different periods. And you could really see the interiors of movies from one movie theater to another, where the Rennell and the Erlen were probably built in the 1920s. The Lane was built in the 40s, and that was, like, very modern. And then they rebuilt the Esquire movie theater. It was called something else.
It was the Grange. Yeah.
Yeah, the Grange, actually, right, thank you. Forgot that name. The Grange, that's right, Grange Street is right there. And they rebuilt that in the 50s. That was where I took my first date to the Esquire movies in the hot shop. Remember, we had cheeseburgers. My first car was a 1946 Ford that I got for $100. And because my parents had an auto supply store, I grew up playing with, you know, tools and car parts. So I made a hot rod out of it. I customized it. Got a job in a body shop, so I have access to spray gun to paint the car. Well, Shy Park, I used to go there a lot. My father actually was a baseball player in the 30s, and he took us to the ball game all the time, pinned the ticket to our shirt. So when I got older, maybe 11 or 12 years old, I went to the ballpark myself. And for some reason, I became a St. Louis Cardinals fan. Back in the 40s, top of the ninth, when Stan Musial and Marty Marion and all those guys came out, shake their hand. Or one time I went there and I only had a quarter, and I bought a hot dog and I bought a Cardinal baseball pennant, which hung on my wall for about 25 years. Anyway, when I got out of the ballpark, I realized I had spent all my money, and I thought I'd just walk home, and I figured Broad Street would be the safest place to walk. So I went to Broad and Lehigh, and then I walked up Broad Street, you know, just goofing around, looking at different places, checking out the stores. I got home probably about 3 hours late, and my mother was panicking, like, oh, where'd you go? I said, oh, I walked home. And she said, okay, be careful or something. And my longest bike ride was from West Oak Lane to Palmyra, New Jersey, over to Tacony-Palmyra Bridge.
Joe, you saw and did a lot, and I'm glad your parents gave you the freedom to explore. You have a lot of good stories. Be well.
Be well. You take care.
Give me land, lots of land, dee-lee-lee-lee, don't dee-lee-lee-lee.
I got it, Don't Fence Me In, written by Cole Porter for the picture Hollywood Canteen in the year 1944, produced by Warner Brothers.
Get your motor running, head out on the highway, looking for adventure, and whatever comes our way, yeah, darling, go. Guns at once and explode into space. Select the two.